Rockefeller Plaza. You're watching Mic'd Up, the Francesa Sports Final. Now, here is your host, Bruce Beck.
30 years ago, Yankees captain Thurman Munson died trying to land his own airplane. Tonight, we'll discuss his enduring legacy. Munson was a seven-time All-Star, a three-time Gold Glove winner, and won two World Championships with the Yankees. He's a man and a player who will never be forgotten.
Munson played baseball with a passion, hitting and fielding.
There aren't really any individual winners in baseball. You can go out and be MVP 5 years in a row, and if you end up in last place, you're not a winner.
Munson helped lead the Yankees back from a long decline in baseball. He was the American League Rookie of the Year in 1970, most valuable player in 1976.
His other passions were his family and flying.
Put on any kind of an act, you just get there and you enjoy yourself. You have to be on your toes, but it's just a kind of relaxation where you spend a lot of time by yourself, and I need that.
New York Yankees catcher Thurman Munson was killed today in the crash of a small airplane.
Rookie of the Year, was an MVP, and now he's dead in Akron, Ohio.
Munson had a .292 lifetime batting average, but the important statistics were age 32, married, the father of three.
Well, we miss him very dearly. He's a nice man, a family man, and everything. He's a wonderful guy.
You like Thurman Munson?
Thurman Munson, who wore the pinstripes with number 15. Number 15 on the field, number 15 for the records, and number 15 for the halls of Cooperstown. But in living, loving, and legend, history will court my friend is number one.
Coinciding with the 30th anniversary of Thurman's death is this wonderful book about his life. It's called Munson, The Life and Death of a Yankee Captain. And joining us in the studio right now is author Marty Appel, baseball historian and former public relations director of the Yankees. Marty, welcome.
Thank you, Bruce. Thanks for having me.
Is it hard to believe that 30 years have passed?
Depends on your age, I guess. I mean, when he died, 30 years back before that was Babe Ruth's death. So, you know, it's relative.
You know, it's one of those moments, I think, where you remember where you were. I was in Long Beach Island at the Jersey Shore. I remember vividly the moment when my friend Dave, Boobs was his nickname, said to me that, you know, Thurman had passed. So it's one of those moments in time, isn't it?
It is. For baseball fans, it's almost the equivalent of where were you when President Kennedy was killed. It really had that kind of an impact on this town.
So, Marty, you co-wrote Munson's own autobiography in 1978. Why now the biography, 30 years later?
Well, all these years, whenever somebody would say, hey, I read that book, it was a terrific book, and I'd be appreciative of the compliment, but in my heart, I knew there was a better story to be told. And he's reached the status now of an American sports icon who was worthy of a full biography. The portrayal of him on that miniseries, The Bronx is Burning, kind of rekindled interest in him because he was an interesting, complex guy. And that got Doubleday, the publisher, interested in the book, and here we are.
What was it like when you went back and listened to those audio cassettes from 1978? How eerie was it when you had a chance to hear Thurman's voice again?
I needed his voice in my head to begin the process. And the tapes were as I remembered them. He didn't want to get too personal, even though it was an autobiography. They were a recounting of the big games and the pennant races. But that left the void as to what was his childhood really like and what drove this man, who became a really interesting character.
And he had a very difficult childhood.
He did. It was a loveless home that went back at least two generations. His three older siblings left home as soon as they got out of high school, leaving him in this environment, which was just so difficult for him. A father who was jealous of him, who yelled into the kitchen table when he was signing his Yankee contract, he ain't too good on pop fouls, you know. A tough, tough situation for him. What saved Thurman was being an elite athlete, staying involved in sports and coaches and teammates year-round, and getting this terrific girlfriend, Diane Dominick, from Canton, a neighbor, at age 12. And her family kind of took him in and gave him a semblance of what it ought to be like.
You were with the Yankees, so you know what Thurman was really like, because here was a guy who fought with the boss, George Steinbrenner. He fought with Reggie. He got in disputes with the fans. He actually once threw the finger at the Yankee faithful. So what was this guy like, this intriguing individual?
Well, the fans never seemed to be bothered by bad press or even a little bad action on the field. They just saw this guy as a winner from the day he arrived. He played the game right. He played the game hard and true. He had the dirtiest uniform, and he led. The pitching staff loved to work with him. He knew the hitters. He knew everything about the game. He was the little general out there at the catching position. And no matter what he did, the fans had a love affair going with him.
An iconic leader, I've heard that term, a clutch player, the first captain for the Yankees since Lou Gehrig. Did he earn all of that?
Oh, he did. And it's interesting, too, the first captain. This was Mr. Steinbrenner and Billy Martin suggested that he should be the captain in 76. Now, I was the only one in the room who happened to remember this obscure little detail about Lou Gehrig. When he died, his manager, Joe McCarthy, said there should never be another Yankee captain. The position dies with Lou. So I brought this up, and Mr. Steinbrenner, to his everlasting credit, looked at me and said, well, Marty, if Joe McCarthy knew Thurman Munson, he'd know this is the right guy and this is the right time. And he was so right.
He was captain of the Bronx Zoo, one of the legendary teams in not only New York sports, but in the history of baseball.
Yeah, but it was not a comfortable position for him because he was never comfortable being in controversy. And now you look back and you go, boy, he was preparing for it as a child because his home life was like that too. But he just, what made him not finally shut off the media was that he was the focal point of everything that was brewing with the Bronx Zoo, and it was the last place he wanted to be. He was not a controversial guy by nature.
There was always a perception that he wanted out of New York. He wanted to go home. He wanted to play for the Indians, get home to where he grew up and where his family was. True?
Well, he didn't want to play for the Indians, but he did want to be closer to home, and the Indians were the solution for him. But when he bought that jet in the end, which he only acquired 3 weeks before he died, it was painted Yankee blue, and the registration number on the tail was NY15. So we knew where his heart was.
Did the boss take over after his death, meticulous about details, arrangements, everything in that regard?
One of his finest hours, and you read it now and you say, this was the boss at the top of his game. After dealing with the grief of the shocking phone call from the airport where he was, oh no, oh no, oh no, suddenly he calls in his senior staff and it's, you guys fly to Canton, do whatever needs to be done. We're wearing black armbands. We're retiring his number. We're putting a plaque on the wall. We're retiring his locker. We're going to have Cardinal Cook here. We're going to leave home plate empty. He did it all in 10 minutes. It was a marvel to watch.
What makes this man unique in my mind, he loved the Three Stooges. He ate Oreos for breakfast. He was complex, single, simple, and intriguing all at once.
Yeah, and he was a player's player. I mean, despite the rough upbringing, you wanted to be with him. He was a regular guy. And to have accomplished that from that tough upbringing, instead of being on a psychiatrist's couch for his whole life, like you and I would have been,
right,
it was a marvelous achievement.
What is Thurman's legacy now and forever?
First captain since Lou Gehrig, MVP, Rookie of the Year, took the team to great glory with 2 world championships and 3 pennants, and played the game right. And he was a fan's kind of player. They saw him and they loved him.
The book is entitled Munson, The Life and Death of a Yankee Captain. And we thank Marty Appel for sharing some thoughts with us on the 30th anniversary of Thurman's tragic death. Thank you, Marty.
Thank you, Bruce.
Coming up next, what's...